We're in Colossians chapter 3. Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians chapter 3. Okay, and then let's just pray. Father, we thank you so much for your word that never returns void. We just thank you, Father, for your blessings upon us, Lord, that we see blessings, God, when they come, Lord, and we don't see the heat, but we see that your good hand upon our lives, Lord. We thank you so much. We just pray a special prayer for MJ, Lord. Her blood pressure has went up, Lord. We just pray, just put your hand on her so she feels better, Lord. We pray for anyone else who is sick, Lord, that in our church here, Lord, just lift them up, bless them, Lord. We pray that people would be able to come and make it to hear the word of God, Lord. We thank you so much. We just ask you just to bless our time now in the word here. We just praise you, Father, now. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, so we're in Colossians chapter 3, and so I want to start out the premise of this, is that you will not live up to this message that I'm about to preach. You will not live up to it, because it's interesting, because the Bible teaches us a certain way, and what it teaches us to be like Christ. Well, Christ was perfect. He was perfect. There was no sin in him. And so what the Bible teaches us to do, it teaches us how to walk in the Spirit, how to be filled with the Spirit, how to think correctly, to have the correct mindset. Because the Bible tells us in Isaiah 55:8 that our thoughts are not God's thoughts and our ways are not God's ways. As a matter of fact, as high as the heavens are, God's thoughts are above our thoughts. And so we don't think with God at all. Before we were saved, we were not able to think one spiritual thought other than how do you get to heaven? And that's what it says in the Bible. 1 Corinthians 2:14 says that the natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him, and he cannot understand them because it takes spiritual discernment. So the natural man is the unsaved person. They are not born again. They are not regenerated. They do not have the Spirit in them. And so the Spirit, our human spirit, communicates with the Holy Spirit. And that's how we're able to know the things of God. The Bible says that in 1 John 2:15, which we're going to get to in our class, it says, you have an anointing from the Holy One, and you know all things. And you have no need that any man teach you. But we are taught by a man. And it's like John's prayer earlier, that we are hearing from the Spirit, even though a man is speaking, but the Spirit is the one who is speaking to you, really. It's the Holy Spirit. Because without the Holy Spirit, you would have no understanding at all of the Scriptures. None at all. And so this is an interesting thing here. So and so you would have no understanding of what positional truth is. I mean, this is a thing for us to grab a hold of, our position in Christ. Because without understanding it, the fact that I am righteous and you are righteous today, not because you do righteous things, but because Jesus was righteous. And the Bible says that he became sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Where's that at? 2 Corinthians 5:21. Very clear in the Bible. It's like you are made righteous. You are made holy. We are called holy ones. We are complete in him. And so, but in my experience, now I have my experience. My experience is I sin. My experience is I fail. And that's why I'm saying that in the beginning that you're not going to live up to this message. But see, it's okay though, because we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. That's good news. That's good news. 1 John 2:1. And what does he plead? He speaks the blood. The blood speaks. His blood speaks better things than the blood of Abel, right? Like it's Hebrews 12:24, right? Is that right? His blood speaks better things than the blood of Abel. Because remember, blood, like Abel, God said, God said his blood cries out to me. But what did Abel's blood cry out? It cried out justice. But Jesus' blood cries out mercy. Mercy. That's why it's better. And mercy rejoices against judgment, the Bible tells us. His mercy rejoices against judgment. That's an amazing thing to think about. So we look at the Bible and we study the Bible. The Bible is a spiritual book. It is spiritual. You know, and Jesus said that the words I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life in John 6:63. They are spirit and they are life. You know, and I'm sorry if I quote like a bunch of scriptures, but it's like, I think that we need the Word of God as our standard of thinking. You know, it's our premise of our thinking. It's the Word of God, John 6:63. It's like, it is our premise of thinking, it is our standard of thinking. Like, because without it, my soul will cleave to the dust, Psalm 119, verse 11. But I'm quickened, made alive again by the Word of God. And so this is what the Bible does. It corrects our thinking. It brings us into a new way of thinking because you have a new mind. He's given us a new heart, Ezekiel 36:26, right? He's given us the mind of Christ, 1 Corinthians 2:16. We have his mind already. We have his mind. And so we're learning, right? As we are growing, we grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, right? 2 Peter 3:18, we grow in grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And so we are learning how to love one another. It's like a process that happens. But without it, without the Spirit, we would never learn it. We would never know what it means to do that. We would have no idea. Because what did Jesus say in John 13:34? That this is a new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another. But he didn't stop there, did he? He said, love one another as I have loved you. So that you may love one another. In other words, that's the commandment. It's in that way. It's in that same way. And how did he love me? While I was a sinner, Romans 5:8, while I was an enemy. Wow, that's pretty serious. While I was an enemy of him. And we were, before we were born again, by the way, we were his enemies. The Bible tells that. We were his enemies. And it says he quickened us and he made us alive together in Christ. In Ephesians chapter 2 talks about this. So in Colossians chapter 3, right in verse 1, let's start. It says, if you then be risen with Christ, and by the way, in the Greek, this is what's called the first class condition, because there are three class conditions in the Greek. The first class condition means if and you are. And it always uses the word if. So if and you are, that's the first class condition. That's what's here. Second class condition means if and you're not. And the third class condition means if and maybe you are and maybe you are not. And it's just a good way to brain out the Greek because it's in the indicative mood, which is the mood of fact. It's a fact. If you then be risen with Christ, and you are. So therefore, if you are risen with Christ, what does it say? Because the Bible tells us what? You were crucified with Christ, right? Galatians 2:20. And you are also risen with him. That's an amazing thing to think about. That is your position in Christ, your position. But my experience on the earth, I don't feel like I'm risen. You know, I feel like I'm like down in the dirt. I feel like I'm no good. But that's not truth. See, that's the devil lies to us and tells you that you're no good and you're not worthy and you'll never amount to anything. But in Christ, you are perfect. You are perfected forever. Actually, the Bible says, right? So if you then be risen with Christ, then what? What do you do? Seek those things which are above. Seek those things which are above, where Christ sits on the right hand of God. Wow. So we seek, you know, we seek for him. And the Bible tells us that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6. And what is the reward that we find him? But what if you never seek for him? You won't find him. Pretty simple, right? But he's a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. And so we seek for truth. And of course, this is talking to born-again believers, right? Because they are risen with him. So if you are risen with him, then you know what? Seek for things on the things above. Because what? We look not at the things that are seen, but the things that are not seen. Because the things that are seen are temporal, but the things that are not seen, they are eternal, right? 2 Corinthians 4:18. We look at those things, but how do you see the things that are not seen? It's by faith, a faith that works by love. Galatians 5:6. Faith works by love. So it says, seek those things are above where Christ sits. He's sitting there now. Why is he sitting? He's not standing, right? He's sitting because the work is finished. The work is finished. There's no more work to do. It's like Jesus completed the work. He said, it is finished, John 19:30. So he's seated at the right hand because what? In the book of Hebrews, the priest, because Jesus is our high priest, right? He's a prophet, priest, and king, the Bible brings out. But he is, and as far as our priesthood goes, because he makes intercession for us, right? And in his priesthood, he is seated at the right hand of the throne of God, because the priesthood in the Old Testament, they were always busy all the time, weren't they? They were working all the time. They were making animal sacrifices every year on the the Day of Atonement. There was one day they would go in and they would sacrifice animals for the atonement for the people. But you know what? They had to come back again the next year because they had sinned all that year again. They had sinned again. As soon as they left, they started sinning. You know, it's like that day, I'm sure they probably started sinning. But they were, it says they were always standing. They were always standing and making the sacrifices all the time. But Jesus is seated, and the right hand of God speaks of, it's a place of honor, the right hand. And why is it a place of honor? Because Jesus, what did he do? He humbled himself, became obedient unto death, even the death of a cross. And so therefore, God has highly exalted him and given him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, every tongue should confess, right, that Jesus Christ is Lord. So he is seated there. Where are you seated at? The Bible tells us in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 6, that you are seated above in heavenly places with Christ Jesus. That's an amazing fact right there. But wait a minute, I think that you're all seated down, except John, John's standing. We are all seated, you are seated in a chair. But the Bible says you are seated above in heavenly places with Christ Jesus. How can that be possible? Because you are with him, because you were risen with him, because you were crucified with him, and you have been risen with him. I mean, this is a great thing to grab a hold of. If we grab a hold of these truths, we will be set free. You see, this is how we get set free. Because Jesus not only saved us from the penalty of sin, right? But he is saving us presently from the power of sin. And how does this come? From the transformation, a new way of thinking, a transformation of the mind, right? So it says, seek those things which are above, where Christ sits at the right hand of God. And then it says, and this is King James, it says, set your affection on things above and not on things on the earth. The Greek word is phroneo, and it means thinking. It means your mindset. It means have a mindset. So in other words, you seek and then you set, right? Because once you find it, you seek the things that are above. And when you find them, then you set your mind on things above, right? So you seek the things that are above. And guess what? God's faithful. He will make it so you will find it. You will find the things above because you are born again. You have the Holy Spirit. And if anyone looks and tries to find, to go after the things of God, Jesus said, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Take no thought for your own life. You know, what you shall eat, what you shall wear. It's like they're meaningless things anyway. God's going to take care of you. You're worth more than all the sparrows, right? It's like you're worth many, many sparrows. You know, and he loves you. He's going to supply you with all his needs. Why? Because he promised that he would. You know, we cast our cares on him. Why? Because he cares for us. That's what the Bible says. And you know what? And God cannot lie, can he? All the promises of God are yea and amen. 2 Corinthians 1:20. They are yes. The promises of God. He cannot lie. Jesus cannot lie. You know, he has promised us eternal life. Titus 1:2. And God cannot lie. The God who cannot lie, he's promised us eternal life. So we have a mindset on things above and not on things on the earth. Wow. Huh. And it says in verse 3, it says, for you are dead. You know, it's in the aorist tense. Now, there are 6 Greek tenses and there's only 3 English, right? Past, present, future. You know, some might argue there's 4, but we're just going to keep it simple. There's past, present, future. Right. And so, but in Greek, there are 6 tenses. Aorist tense means it happened at a specific point in time, a specific point in time. You know, it wasn't continuous action. It was punctiliar action. It was happened in a point in time. So in other words, it says a better translation would be say, for you have died. Then maybe that would be better. You have died. You know, why? Because doesn't that go along maybe with Galatians 2:20? It says, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me. And the life that I now live, I live by what? The faith of the Son of God. Wow, we live by faith now because we don't see God. He's invisible. You know, God is invisible. But though you've never seen him, yet you love him, right? And we rejoice with joy unspeakable. We've never seen him. You know, I think it's amazing that Peter wrote that in 1 Peter 1:8. You know, kind of like how John was writing to second generation Christians in 1 John, as we brought out. Well, Peter said it too, because Peter had been with Jesus, and he says, though you've never seen him, yet you love him and rejoice with joy unspeakable. Well, Jesus, Peter had seen him. Oh yeah, he's seen him. He had been with us. Very obvious. It's in the Bible. You know, he spent a lot of time with Jesus. You know, I think it's kind of interesting too. I'm kind of getting sidetracked here a little bit. You know, that there were things like about Peter. You know, there's something I was thinking about, like about Peter, that like all his mishaps and stuff like were written in there and the things that he did, you know, but it's like, but what if Peter sat back and just like didn't do anything? There'd be nothing written about him, you know, like, it would be nothing, right? Because there was other disciples too, right? But there's really not much written about him other than their name in there. You know, you wonder why, because like they didn't, like, what were they doing? You know, I don't know. You know, I'm not saying, I'm not judging them, but I'm just saying that, you know, it's like, but Peter, though, is like Peter, but, and he did all these things that were like, wow, Peter, you know, but Peter, he grew. Wow, that's hope for me, isn't it? Well, I might be immature, but so was Peter, and Peter grew into maturity. And the very last thing he said in 2 Peter 3:18 is the last verse there. It says, grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He knew what it meant to grow by experience. He had experiential understanding of that. That's an amazing thing. Okay, let's get back on track. We got sidetracked. So, yeah. So, it says, for you have died, and your life is hid with Christ in God. This is loaded here. It says, you have died, and your life is hid with Christ in God. What does this mean? It's like, it's kind of like, you know, in the times whenever, like, Paul the Apostle was writing, he talked about these mysteries. There was these mysteries that was given to Paul the Apostle. And back then, there was these cults. And there's cults today, right? There's a big cult in Clearwater, right? You know, there are cults today. But in some of these cults, in order to know anything at all about what the cult teach, initiated into the cult, you know, because if you didn't go into the cult, but as soon as you got initiated into the cult, they revealed to you all their secrets, but you weren't supposed to tell anybody the secret. So nobody would know about what the secrets were. But isn't that kind of like us in a way? We have the Holy Spirit in us, you know, and you know things that no one knows in the whole world. You know, it's like they can't know it, because they don't have the Spirit of God in them. And although we proclaim everything and bring it out into the open and don't hide things from people, yet they don't understand it because they don't have the Spirit in them. And so this is what it means. You are dead. You have died, and your life is hid with Christ in God. It's like this unseen world that people, they look at you and either it's like they don't understand. You know, even like Jesus' disciples didn't understand a lot of things that Jesus said. They just like, what? But you know what? They would go and ask him. You know, Jesus would speak in parables, you know, and it's like, and they were like, what are you talking about, Jesus? And then he would tell them plainly what he meant. He would interpret it. You wouldn't have to try to, I'm glad he did, because people would have come up with all kinds of wacky stuff about what he meant, you know, but he interpreted it himself, didn't he? You know, so I mean, it would have, you know, but thank God he gave us his own commentary. It's like, thank you, Jesus. You know, so it's like, so your life is hid with Christ in God. Now, Christ in God. It's like he is our intercessor, Jesus. I mean, think about it. It's like he is the way to God. Like, if we turn to John 17 real quick, just keep it right there, and hopefully we don't get too long here, but I was going to do this whole thing right here, but this was Jesus' prayer, that he prayed this prayer before, John, the Gospel of John, in John chapter 17, And this was his prayer, and he was praying for the disciples. Interesting, because he knew that he was about to get captured, you know, that Judas was coming. He was on the way with the men with the torches and stuff. And so Jesus was praying to the Father. And, you know, it was something I noticed, too, that there was no white light that shone out of heaven. God the Father didn't all of a sudden, "Yes, Son, I'm here," like a big white light, you know. It's kind of like us. We pray to God, you know, but we don't always, he's not going to come with this shining light. You know what I'm saying? And Jesus, the Son of God, prayed to the Father like that way. And there was the Father was there and he heard the prayers. You understand what I'm saying? You understand what I'm getting at? In other words, like there was in the prayer here, if you look, the Father did not have a conversation with him. It was Jesus speaking, you know, and that's the way how we pray too. You know, we think that maybe like Jesus is like us in a lot of ways, you know, with his prayer, you know, and so am I making sense? Maybe I'm not. So this is like, it says that, but Jesus, he wasn't praying for himself. What he was praying for this. Let's look in verse 21. It says that they may all be one as thou, Father, art in me and I in thee. Wow. It's like he is in the Father and we are in Christ. Think about that. Like he is in the Father and we are in Christ. He is the intermediator between God and man. He says, and he said, this was his prayer. He says, in verse 21, it says, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. Because they were about to go out and commission and what? John the Apostle, like, was going to go and preach about Jesus, and they had never seen him before. People would proclaim, you know, I had been with Jesus, Peter. And then in verse 22, it says, and the glory which thou gave me, I have given them, that they may be one, even as we are one. It says, I in them, and thou in me. Verse 23, I in them, and thou in me. In other words, like, he is in them, his life is in us, and the life of the Father was in Jesus, right? And so we get to the Father through Jesus. And it says that they may be perfect in one, and that the world may know that thou hast sent me and has loved them as thou hast loved me. Wow. The Father loves you just as much as he loves Jesus? That is an amazing thing. Wow. Why would he love you as much as he loves Jesus? Because you are in him. You are perfect. You are complete. You have his righteousness. You have Jesus' righteousness. You have everything. The Bible says, as he is, so are we in this present world. In 1 John 3, right? As he is, so are we in this present world. As he is what? As he is righteous. As he is holy. As he is perfect. Wow, that's my position with him. And that can never be taken away because of sin. Because of acts of sin in my life. Because guess what? You're going to sin. So what's going to happen when you sin? Guess what? We come to God. We come boldly to the throne of grace to find help in time of need. We confess our sins. He's faithful and just to forgive us of our sins. That is of the guilt of sin and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. See, we are learning. It's kind of like you learn to ride a bike, right? I like using bike illustrations for some reason because I have a bunch of bikes, right? So, but when you first learn, especially if you mountain bike and you're on some rough terrain, guess what's going to happen? You are going to fall. I guarantee it. If you don't fall, you're not riding on rough enough terrain. You're on flat ground, probably. But if you're going to ride and get serious about it, you are going to fall off that bike. And you know what? You're going to do it a lot. You're going to get up. But what do you do when you fall down? Oh, I'm so guilty and so shameful. It's like, do you get like that? No, you get up and you've got a little bit of blood right here. And you're like, okay, I'll take care of that later. You know, and you dust the bike. When you get back, you can put some water on it or something like that and get it off, you know. So, really, that's what you do, right? So, but you get up and you go again. And then you fall again. You fall again, you know. And even a good bike rider, a good mountain bike rider, they fall. Guess what? They fall. I'm not looking at her. It's like, they fall, you know. They do. Because it happens from time to time. But what do? You get back up and you ride the bike again. You keep going. You're not guilty. You're not shameful or anything like that. But you are learning and you are practicing. And the more you practice, the better you get at it. You know, you get better at it. You get better at it. You get better at it. So we are learning to walk with God and be spiritually minded. To set your mind on things above. Have the mindset, right? Perfect peace has he whose mind is stayed on thee because he trusts in thee. Isaiah 26:3, yes. And also, like Psalm chapter 1, blessed is the man that walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, right? Blessed is the man that walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor sits in the way of sinners, or no, that stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord. And in his law does he meditate day and night. Yeah. And what does this say will happen to him? He will be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that gives forth, that whose leaf does not wither and gives forth its fruit in its season. So his fruit that comes, you see, is like meditate on the word, his delight. His delight is in the law of the Lord. It's like, this is the key thing here. Like 1 Peter 2:2, it says, like as newborn babes to desire the sincere milk of the word that you may grow thereby. That's the key right there, is to desire it. And then it says, if you have, the next verse says, if you have tasted that the Lord is gracious. If you just happened to taste that he was gracious, hopefully you did. Because if you did, you would taste the good word of the Lord. And you would know that he's good and he's gracious and he's kind and he loves us. And it's like, and that draws you to him. That's what we lift up Christ, and he will draw all men unto himself, right? John 12:35, I think it is. Or is that right? I will draw all men. You've got the walking Bible concordance over here. So just kidding. I don't mean to put you on the spot there. Okay, so where are we at here? Colossians. Okay. Back to Colossians. Okay. So, yeah, Colossians, it says, for you have died and your life is hid with Christ in God. I mean, I think that's amazing, that Christ in God. Then it says in verse 4, it says, when Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall you also appear with him in glory. So this life that is hid, that is not seen, it's not revealed, that the world can't see it, it's going to be manifested, you know? And the Bible says that when he does appear, that when Christ appears, that you shall be like him, for you shall see him as he is. So when Christ does appear, we will see him, and we will see all these things, and the hidden things will no longer be hidden anymore. They will not be hidden. So, in Colossians chapter 3, verse 4. So we could keep on going here, because actually all of this is really loaded here. All of this right here is like, you know, put off the old man, put on the new. But we're going to cut it short here. Putting off the old man, put on the new. In other words, like, it's like changing your clothes. You know, that's why it says mortify, therefore. Mortify, put to death your members upon the earth. It says, like, you know, your hands, your eyes, your feet, your tongue, your mouth. Like those things. Like, what did Jesus say? Like, if your hand offends you, cut it off. If your eye offends you, pluck it out. We know somebody who did that. He actually plucked his eye out because he had a problem with lust. And he actually plucked his eye out. You know, I was like, whoa. You know, but it's like, but Jesus didn't mean that. He didn't mean to literally do it. He just meant to stop doing it. You know, stop doing it. Put to death, therefore, your members upon the earth. Why? Put off the old man. You know, in other words, like you're changing clothes because it's not who you are. See, those things are not who you are. That's what it teaches, right? It's the grace of God that teaches us to deny ungodliness and worldly lust. Wow, because it isn't who we are anymore. So it's like if we understand like what our position is in him, and who you are in him, and that the fact that all of your sins have been removed, taken away, they're not there anymore, even though we commit sins. He's the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This drives me and motivates me and enables me to live this experiential life now, to be saved from the power of sin. You know, too many times that we hear that, you know, people telling you, don't do this, don't do that. Well, that was the Old Testament. Do this, don't do that. You know, but the New Testament says that we love him because he loved us. That's the reason why. And if you love me, you'll keep my commandments, Jesus said. If you love me, that's the key right there. So this goes on and on in here. I mean, this is all really good stuff right here. And so, but we could keep on going for next couple hours, but I think we won't. But anyway, but it's good. It is good stuff. You know, it is like loaded here in the Bible. We're just going to keep on going with grace because it's grace. It's the grace of God that enables me. What? We're saved by grace. Ephesians 2:8. We grow in grace, 2 Peter 3:18. We stand in grace, Romans 5:2. And we're taught by grace in Titus 2:11. You know, we're established in grace, right? Hebrews 12, something in there is like we are established in grace. It's like it is the grace of God. We make an emphasis on it. We grow in grace and knowledge. The knowledge. So it's the knowledge of his love that brings me to light. And whenever we see love, what? We see his light at the same time. So, amen. So, Father, we thank you. We thank you so much for your word, God, that comes in. Your word is truth. And we're sanctified by truth, Father God, in John 17:17. We thank you so much for your words, Jesus, that bring life to us and change us. And that you came not only just to save us from the penalty of sin, but from the power of sin in our lives. It's much more. Your salvation is complete and perfect, and we will be saved from the presence of sin in the future. And Father, we thank you. We just ask you just to bless our rap time afterwards, our conversation about you. Let it be anointed of you and spirit-filled thinking in the word. And if there's anyone out there who's never received Jesus as your Savior, this is your opportunity to please accept him today. The Bible says it's a free gift. You know, it is a free gift. It is between you and God. It is a free gift. Just ask him to save you. Say, dear Lord Jesus, come into my heart and save me and give me the free gift of eternal life. I want to go to heaven when I die. Come in my heart and save me. You're accepting salvation from Jesus. He gives it to whosoever will. Whosoever will. Whosoever will come to him, he will give them eternal life. He promised it. And so if you've said that, you are born again. If you accepted Jesus as your Savior, you are saved. You are born again. And, you know, send me an instant message on Facebook. I'd love to talk to you or give me a call. It's my phone number is 727-452-7445. Everybody should have my phone number. And also we have a website. It's greatergrace.church. And so amen.